TV antennas use elements to pull in over-the-air signals, but what is the best material to make these elements from? Does it really make a difference? And if so, how big of a difference? Today I'm going to find out, so let's hop to it. There are a lot of instructions for building do-it-yourself TV antennas, including my designs that I have posted on this channel. All TV antenna designs have one thing in common. They have at least one piece of conducting material, usually metal, called the element that receives the broadcast transmissions. This element can be made out of all sorts of metals, including copper, steel, aluminum, and more. Which should you use? I'm positive that in a lab there will be measurable differences, but our antennas aren't made for the lab. They are made to pull in signals in real-world situations. So I'm going to do a real-world test of a few different metals and see if they affect the performance of my TV reception. For my more technical viewers, this is just going to be a simple, non-scientific test, but I'm hoping the outcome will be clear. Make sure to watch until the end of this video to see the results. Before I start on the actual testing, I should just give a brief breakdown of why there is a difference in what type of metal you select for your antenna element. All metals have a resistance factor to electricity. The lower the resistance, the better the metal conducts. The radio waves that an antenna receives are electromagnetic in nature. They come in contact with the antenna's element, travel along the outer surface of it, and then they are carried through the wired connection to your TV, where they are translated into picture and sound outputs. An element with lower resistance will allow this action to occur more efficiently and will give you better reception. If you look at a chart of the most common metals and the resistances, you can see that copper and aluminum are right there towards the top of the chart. Silver is actually number one, so why don't we just make our antennas out of silver? Well, the most obvious reason is the price of silver. Gold is number three on the chart, but for the same reason as silver, I doubt if any do-it-yourselfers are going to use gold. Copper and aluminum are great materials to make your elements from. Not only are they good conductors, they are easy to obtain, easy to work with, and fairly inexpensive to buy. Quite a few of the do-it-yourself antennas are made with steel elements, like coat hangers or heavy picture or binding wire. A couple of my latest designs actually use galvanized wire, and they work quite well. If we refer to the chart again, steel is not even on the list. In theory, that would make copper and aluminum much better for reception. But in its defense, steel wire elements are even more cost-effective, easy to obtain, very easy to work with, and have proven itself to as a viable antenna material. I'm interested in how it actually will compare. Another thing I want to test is if a twisted element bundle will perform better than a single element wire. I've had a lot of comments saying it will. Well, like I always say, that's enough talking, let's get to building. Here are the materials that I will be making the antennas from. First up is 16 gauge galvanized steel wire. This is available in 200 foot rolls. It's thin but easy to form, durable, and can hold its shape, especially in smaller hoops. It's also very inexpensive. I've used this on my last two antenna designs. Next is 14 gauge copper. This is a wire that I took out of some standard Romex house wire. It is also easy to form, is fairly light, and will also hold its shape for small hoop elements. I'll also use 12 gauge copper Romex wire. It's a bit stiffer than the 14 gauge and a bit more expensive. Also in 12 gauge, I have some aluminum wire. This is used to make crafts and jewelry, and I purchased it in a 100 foot roll. It is very flexible, very light, and also easy to shape. Let's try a piece of 10 gauge Romex wire. It's even thicker than the 12 gauge copper, more difficult to bend, and costs even more. Finally, I have some quarter inch copper tubing. Because it's hollow, it's light, easy to bend, and will hold its shape even better than the wires. I want to add this to the testing to see if going with an element form with a thicker cross section will increase gain and reception. To make it an even playing field, I will make each of these elements into a 9-inch diameter vertical hoop antenna. A matching transformer will be used to attach the coax cable to my test TV. Keep in mind that I'm not as worried about the optimum performance of these antennas, but rather how these antennas compare to each other. I first measure and cut each of the elements to a length of 28 inches. Next, I take 1/2 inch of the wire at each end and bend them into terminal hooks. I end up with element lengths of 27 inches. For the tubing, I clamp each end in a vise and flatten them. Next, I drill holes through them for the terminal screws. I take each of the cut elements and, using a paint can as a form, I shape each one into a hoop. To make a quick and easy antenna mount, I cut a piece of scrap PVC board. To mount the antenna, I first drill a hole so I can run a screw through into the top of a mounting pole. Next, I measure out 2 spots on the side of the board, 1.5 inches apart. I drill in a couple of pilot holes, then screw in 2 lathe screws to act as terminals. The finished mount is screwed into a PVC cap that's been cemented on a piece of PVC pipe. I'm installing this in my usual TV antenna test room, which is a second floor bedroom. Everything is glued, clamped, and secured in place, so the only thing that will change is the antenna elements themselves. The first element to be tested is the 14-gauge galvanized wire. When attaching each of the elements, I measure the hoop and try to adjust them so all the antennas are as uniform to each other as possible. I'm also careful to aim each antenna in the same precise location towards a distance station, channel 62. I know all of these elements will be able to pull up the strong local stations, so I'm much more interested to see how they compare with the weaker ones. I run a full channel scan. When it's complete, I record the received channels and what each channel registers on the TV signal strength meter. Normally, a small non-amplified hoop antenna like these will receive a total of 39 channels. I switch out the antenna element and repeat this test. After all the elements were tested, I compiled results. All the elements received 39 stations, but there are differences in measured signal strength. My TV signal meter measures from 0 to 4, so I took all of the readings per element and totaled them up to create a chart. The maximum an element could score is 156, which is 39 stations times the maximum reading of 4. In reality, this would be a highly improbable total for such a basic antenna, as there are too many signal variances. As expected, the galvanized wire was the least efficient. Not only is it the poorest conductor, but it also is the lightest gauge wire I tested, giving it the least amount of surface area. It scored a 114 and is only 87% as efficient compared to the best element I tested. Here is a bar graph showing how all the elements compare with each other. 14 gauge copper and 14 gauge aluminum wire both rated the same. They both have the same efficiency rating, which is 91% as efficient as the best element, with each scoring 119. It's interesting that the 12 gauge copper wire also scored 119. The 10-gauge copper wire was the overall winner with a score of 131. I was surprised that it actually tested slightly better than the quarter-inch copper tube. To be certain, I cleaned up and reattached the tube and tested it again, with the exact same results. The tubing tested slightly less efficient at 130, or 99%. My next test was to create a twisted wrap of wire to see if the added cross-section would help the reception. I chose the galvanized wire as it tested the weakest. To make this element, I locked 3 of the galvanized wires, 1 at 28 inches and 2 at 27 inches, into a vise. Each end has 1/2 inch of 28-inch wire sticking out farther to act as a terminal end. I clamped the other ends of the wires in a cordless drill and slowly twist them into a tight bundle. The test of this antenna is very interesting, as it did increase the signal reception of the single wire. In fact, it tested 95% as efficient as the 10-gauge copper, which is an increase of 8% versus the single galvanized element. You can see the twisted galvanized wire was outperforming the copper and aluminum single-gauge elements. This makes me wonder, if the weakest element showed this type of increase, then what would twisting 3 10-gauge wires do? I cut 3 lengths of the copper wire and twist it into a bundle. I attached a new element to my test mount and run the channel scan. Surprisingly, the twisted bundle tested the exact same as the single element time gauge wire did. I assume that this means that I've already achieved maximum performance for the simple 9-inch hoop antenna. So what does all of this have to do with the do-it-yourself antenna builder? Obviously, if you need the best element, spend the money and use 10-gauge copper wire. If you are lucky and in an area with strong TV signal and you don't care about trying to get weaker distance stations, then save some money and galvanized wire will work just fine. If you want to play around with an element with more gain, you may want to try making a twisted bundle element. I'm interested in all of your thoughts, so please leave me your comments. Please high-five the like icon, jingle the bell, and subscribe to my channel. Thanks again to everyone who's already subscribed. You are all truly appreciated. Until next time, keep watching TV.